So the next problem is that we have two edges, one, as you'll see, on top of the other upside down. And what we want to do is find the minimum acceleration of the bottom prism and also find the maximum acceleration of the bottom prism. And then we want to know, you know, a few different things, such as what would happen to these systems if they were left on their own, and how they change the function of the tilt based on a normal force. And then, you know, would treating these blocks as one system be of any use to us?
So we do have friction, right, in this one?
Yes. And the angle here is theta, and the angle up there is theta.
Nice.
All right. Okay. So what do you want to know? The minimum and maximum acceleration of the bottom.
No. You have to do the problem. Can you do the problem, or do you need to know something?
Oh.
What do you want? Where do you want the advice?
I guess the one thing to look at would be whether we should treat the blocks as one system or as two different systems.
Okay. Well, you have your choice. So, first of all, I want to simplify this problem. I want to do it without friction to start off. So this is one. This is two. This is the force.
Wait. So how can there be no friction? Isn't friction the only thing holding up that second block?
Okay. Say that I didn't push it at all, and there was no friction. What would happen?
It would slide off.
Right. This one would slide down, because this one, if there's no friction in the bottom here, then they go like this, right?
Okay.
Now, what if I came along and pushed it incredibly fast? Incredibly
hard. If it's so fast, then
there's a component.
Should fly up.
There's a component of the normal force that's pushing it up and holding it up.
Normal force, that's right.
And so, basically, this thing would get launched into the air. And that's unfortunately what happens sometimes when cars hit pedestrians. The hood is slanted like this, and people get hit by the car, and then they travel. You know, you'll read these terrible stories and they travel 30 feet and then they land, usually not completely healthy. Okay, so therefore, in between, you might think that you could find just right force. Such that it would be balanced. No force, it slides down. Lots of force, it gets shot up, goes up. Intermediate force, what? So now the question is, find F that implies no slip. All right. Well, and then your question, Ryan, is the whole system. And since they're not slipping, they have the same acceleration, so I can do that. Okay? So what's going to happen is Newton's third law in the x direction, Newton's second law in the x direction, the sum of the forces in the x direction equals the total mass, m1 plus m2 times the acceleration in the x direction. I'll just call that A. And this is equal to F, and the masses are given. So therefore, I can find, I'll just write it out here, A equals F divided by M1 plus M2. Okay. Great. That tells you the acceleration that goes with F. But it doesn't tell you what any of the forces are, and it doesn't tell you, it just says F is equal to, is related to A, but it doesn't say how big it is. Okay, so what do we have to do next?
Should we look at the internal forces?
Okay, so let's just look at one system. So we want to look at the internal force. And so let's just take a look at system equals block 2. So here's block 2. And let's draw the force line. All right, there's gravity. And there is a normal force, which we don't know how big it is, but that's what we're going to hopefully find out, or at least some relationship between that and
and other things.
Okay, now we also know that this thing is going here in the x direction with acceleration a. So again, this is Newton's laws applied, and that means F equals ma. So we look in the x direction, and we have, now let's see, this is study theta.
Yeah.
That angle is, so theta gets small, that normal force gets small too, so it's theta also. And so we have in the x direction n sine theta and then we have mg, m2g, but that's going straight down, and this is equal to m2a. Another equation, in the y direction, n, now the y direction up and down, is n cosine theta minus m2g equals m2ay, and what's the y acceleration of block 2?
This is 0, because it's just, we're trying to find where it stays on, right?
Trying to find where it stays.
So 0.
So this is equal to 0. And so right away, that expression there says n equals m2g divided by cosine theta. Okay, now I can plug back into here, and I can say m2a equals n sine theta, and the result of that is going to be that a equals m2g times sine theta and I have to put the m2g over cosine theta. And this is m2a. So the m2s cancel out. And a equals tangent theta times g. Okay, I like that answer. It's got obviously the right units, proportional g. I think everything's proportional g. And now I can combine this with this to find the force. Okay, so I didn't have to use the F equals ma equations for block 1. Had I done so, I wouldn't have had to use the F equals ma equations for the whole system. But it turns out that it was a little bit more insightful to do it this way than to work through the equations for block 1 and then show that the x components of the normal force cancel out, blah, blah, blah. Okay, now this is simpler than the problem that we actually were given. So how do we make this problem into the one that's that was actually given in homework?
Is that the first
add friction to our force equations.
Okay. Now it says find the maximum, find the minimum. Which does it say?
Both.
Both. Okay. So let's just say we're going to have some friction. And we're trying to find the max allowed F. And whenever we have friction, what do we have to figure out first?
Normal force.
No, what kind of friction?
Yeah, sure.
So we're looking for the maximum and the minimum.
So let's just look for the maximum.
Okay, so if we're looking for the maximum friction, maximum acceleration. The friction, so the block's going really fast.
So we're trying to push the block really hard.
And without friction, the block would fly off the top, so friction must be acting sort of downwards,
right,
to the right.
So, exact, good analysis. If we're really good, what's the maximum force, max acceleration, then we know that this thing is going to get thrown off, accelerate up the plane, essentially, and that friction is going to try to prevent that. And so the friction force is going to act here, and it's going to be down this way. Now, what kind of friction is it? Kinetic? Static?
Static.
A because we don't want it to be moving.
Right. So now what's the expression for static friction? For static friction, this is a problem for a lot of people.
The static friction is not just one value, but the maximum.
Less than or equal to.
Yeah.
Then what?
Mu normal force.
Normal force, and this is the static coefficient friction. Okay. Now, in this case, can you argue that it is an equal sign? Otherwise, you have to determine the static friction from the constraint on the acceleration that things are static. And it may take little force. Okay, so I'm standing here. There's some static coefficient between me and the rug. Maybe it's 0.4. Your rug's not usually very slippery. But that does not mean this my normal force times 0.4 is a static friction, because I'm standing here and I'm not accelerating to the right or to the left, and so the net x force on me better be zero. And that would be the only thing that the x direction can be on me is a static friction. So the static friction is zero, and then even if I started to move to accelerate, the static friction would only be big enough to make me accelerate as fast as I accelerate. And as long as that was less than helps not to step on your shoelaces, they have very high static friction, put it that way. The force is less than the static friction times normal. And until I get to the point where I start to slip, that's the only point you can apply this equality. But here, this says, what's the maximum force you can have? So that means that it is on the verge of slipping at that point. So we can say here, F equals the normal force times the static coefficient of friction, and it's operating in that direction. So now there's going to be a component of force in both of these equations. It's going to be a component in the x direction, which is F cosine theta. And there's going to be a component in the y direction, which is minus f sine theta. So solving these equations is going to be less straightforward than it was before. But, okay. Now, I think there's one more query relevant to this question.
Yeah, so in the next problem, same setup, except no friction here. And there's a block on top. And here there's friction between this wedge and this block.
Okay.
And actually, the only question we have for this one is, what system do we want to take? And what things can be combined as one system to answer?
Well, do you have any idea? Can you consider that, okay, so maybe this is 3, let's just call it M3, okay? What system do you want to take? If you look at this solution, what would you like to do?
So we'd like to make everything still accelerate, same acceleration, still
okay.
A static problem, sort of.
Mm-hmm.
And so you could take these two things to be the same system. Right.
Which is what we did over there.
If you want to like look at the friction force.
Well, maybe. with or without 3?
Without 3.
Well,
if you want to look at the friction force, right? Could you take all of them and be the same system?
Okay. The rule for taking all of them is the same system.
They're accelerating the same rate.
They have the same acceleration.
And
so,
that's what we want, and so we can.
Okay, fine. So if there is here, then yeah, you just say, well, for the first part, I'm taking the system as being everything. I just add in an M3 there, right? And for this part here, I would just say I would take blocks 2 and 3. And so here, every place I had an M2, I would just make it M2 plus 3, M2 plus 3, and so on. So I would actually get exactly the same result. Okay. Now, having made that assumption, though, there's one thing. At the end, you have to check that everything's accelerating the same. So now, what condition does that impose on the problem? Okay, you want to satisfy F equals MA for block 3.
Yeah.
And so, if I look up here at block 3, here it is. There's a normal force, there's an M3G, and since it's not accelerating slipping, it's not accelerating up and down. So AY equals 0. And so in this case, the normal force will equal M3G. Okay? But how do we make it accelerate in Y direction? In the X direction, horizontally.
Add a friction force?
Yes, it has a friction force. So I can go over here and say, all right, so I'm going to have F3, right, the friction force on block 3. And so I'm going to have F. So when I look at the X forces, some of the on block 3, the X forces, I find that it's F3. And F3 has to equal M3 times A, and this is the same as the A all throughout the problem, right? So, then I can work out from, so now I know that I have static friction, right? So F3 better be less than or equal to mu3, mu static, okay, but and times the normal force on 3, and we already solved for that, that's M3G. And so what you're going to wind up here is that you need, the implication is this all works only if mu S is greater than some amount, which you'll satisfy. You have to calculate from all these things. But I think you have to go back. It's basically going to be that it's got to be bigger than the tangent of theta, I think, will work out in the end. But I'll leave that as an exercise. You can work it away from solving. And that's the end of office hours for this week. And we apologize to anyone who's had the patience to bear with us for our technical difficulties.